Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Dozens of Afghan civilians killed in NATO raid. Israel and Hezbollah exchange blame for border escalation. And France declares war on Al-Qaeda in Arab Maghreb. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
السلام عليكم. نقل مراسل الجزيرة في أفغانستان.
According to our Al Jazeera correspondent in Afghanistan, in what was attributed to local residents, 28 Afghan civilians were killed in a U.S. airstrike that targeted several pedestrians in Shirsad district in the eastern province of Nangarhar.
In another development, the Taliban has claimed responsibility for the downing of a NATO helicopter in eastern Afghanistan's Kandahar province. A Taliban spokesman said that his fighters fired a shell at the helicopter that was hovering at a low altitude, killing everyone on board.
This is not the first time that Afghan civilians are killed by U.S. airstrikes. Afghan civilians have fallen victim to similar attacks, which recently witnessed a steady escalation. A few days ago, nearly 40 Afghan civilians were killed in an airstrike that targeted the district of Sangin in the southern province of Helmand. Today's raid comes one day after the top U.S. commander in Afghanistan, General David Petraeus, issued new instructions described as tactful. It's unclear, however, whether these new instructions cancel previous orders issued by Petraeus upon his arrival to Afghanistan a few weeks ago. Petraeus instructed his forces to avoid civilian casualties and property losses. Observers believe that the targeting of civilian forces will further fuel anger in Afghanistan, as well as escalate attacks of armed fighters on ISAF forces. The Taliban has strongly criticized Petraeus and accused him of laying down a new strategy for the mass murdering of Afghan civilians.
Nearly 90
Afghan civilians have been killed in the past 2 weeks alone. Afghan President Hamid Karzai strongly criticized NATO and U.S. forces, following the death of several Afghan civilians in attacks on Taliban strongholds in the south.
وبالنظر إلى التطورات الميدانية المتسارعة بدأ قادة عسكريون كبار يظهرون عدم ارتياحهم.
Amidst the escalating developments on the ground, several senior Afghan military commanders said that they are not happy with the way combatant operations are going due to rising casualties and losses among their forces. Chairman of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Michael Mullen, said that the mission of the international forces in Afghanistan is passing through a decisive stage and that it's also facing mounting pressure. Analysts believe that the pressure is not due to the cost of war per se, but as part of humanitarian concerns. This news comes after secret files about the Afghan war were leaked to news services at the end of last month. Based on initial media reports, Human Rights Watch found that the leaked files revealed civilian casualties and combatant operations that were reported by U.S. forces.
المدنيين في عمليات قتالية لم يعترف الجانب الأمريكي بوقوعها.
This will definitely increase the level of embarrassment for the Obama administration over a war that seems far from being settled.
يبدو أن حسمها أمر بعيد المنال.
قالت قوة الأمم المتحدة لحفظ السلام في جنوب
The United Nations peacekeeping forces in southern Lebanon, UNIFIL, said that the Israeli soldiers were working on the Israeli side of the blue line when the border clash with the Lebanese army started. This comes as the US said that the Lebanese army's firing on the Israeli army was wholly unjustified.
مبرر إطلاقا.
الله يديمكم يا شباب.
الحزن خيم على جنوب لبنان لمقتل اثنين من جنود الجيش.
One day after clashing with Israeli soldiers in the Lebanese-Israeli border, sadness overwhelmed southern Lebanon after the death of two Lebanese soldiers and one journalist.
آثار ذلك الاشتباك ما زالت ظاهرة في بلدة العديس الحدودية.
Traces of the clash are still visible in the border town of Odessa, close to the blue line that temporarily demarcates the Lebanese-Israeli border.
غير نهائية. هذه النقطة المتقدمة في منطقة العديس تلخص الواقع.
This advanced position in the region of Odessa summarizes the situation on the ground. Over here, there's heavy presence of Lebanese soldiers in one of their main positions. Just meters away, one can see the United Nations forces that work in southern Lebanon. And also, just a few meters away, but from behind the fence, lie the Israeli positions.
هناك المواقع الإسرائيلية. أما الوجود العسكري غير ظاهر في هذه المنطقة.
As for the unseen military presence in this region, it is of course held by Hezbollah. Israeli soldiers were monitoring the situation from behind their fortified positions, which reflect the tension that still dominates over there. However, some Odessa residents said that the circumstances won't make them leave.
قالوا إن تلك الحال لم تدفعهم إلى المغادرة.
We were born in this country and will remain in this country. Our children will be raised here. We won't build anywhere else. We will live on our land. This land is ours. How can we leave it?
We, the residents of Adaisi, have been getting shelled inside our homes by Israel since 1975, and we're still here.
The Lebanese army's most senior commanders visited the border. The Lebanese army commander, General Jean Kashkwaji, inspected the site of the clashes in Adaisi. He told soldiers and officers that the Israeli army bears a responsibility for the clash due to its entry into the border area claimed by Lebanon. Kakwaji ordered the army to be on alert, prepared and ready to offer more sacrifices. UNIFIL followed up on this position, as well as the Israeli positions, which suggests that the current calm may not last for very long. In turn, UNIFIL increased its patrols along the border, specifically between Adaisi and Kfar Kila, where streets were less busy than normal.
People know. They say that if something happens, if it gets worse or anything, people have taken that into account.
Everyone should be steadfast and remain in their homes.
The road patrolled by Israeli forces was near empty between Adaisi and Kfar Kila. Some explained that the cause might be that the measures talked about by Israel might be implemented far away from the border, away from the Lebanese army and Hezbollah's radars. Mohammed Noon, BBC, Al Adaisi, Southern Lebanon.
قال حزب الله إن التهدئة التي أعلنها أمينه العام لا تعني.
Hezbollah has said that the pacification announced by its Secretary General does not imply keeping quiet. Hezbollah political bureau member Haleb Abu Zainab told the BBC that maintaining the calm is limited by time, as Lebanon is monitoring the situation both internally and on its southern front.
The southern Lebanese border has calmed down. However, analysis of the repercussions and meanings of the border confrontation between the Lebanese army and the Israeli forces have not subsided. Calm on the southern and internal fronts returned as the exchange of sharp statements stopped. They will be replaced by either silence or the announcement of a commitment.
The Secretary General was clear about this direction, that there are good efforts and that we are heading towards some sort of pacification. But this does not mean keeping quiet or being content with the situation. Rather, there is a phase or period that should be accorded in order to do what needs to be done. In turn, this means that there is a limited time. It won't be indefinitely available. إلى
أبد الأبدين. لكن لأمين عام حزب الله. For Hezbollah's Secretary General, this means a new position. He said that they won't tackle the international tribunal, but that evidence from the international investigation implicating Israel will be revealed for the first time.
Turning now to the north of the country, where tensions remained high along the border with Lebanon today, with a significant presence of both Israeli and Lebanese troops deployed on both sides. UNIFIL forces today inspected the site of yesterday's deadly exchange of gunfire in the Galilee Panhandle, in which one Israeli reserve soldier was killed and another seriously injured. Three Lebanese soldiers and one journalist were also killed in the shooting. UNIFIL sources said that yesterday's IDF activity in the area did not warrant the attack launched by Lebanese soldiers. For its part, the IDF continues to maintain that the soldiers were performing routine operations within a specific border enclave on Israeli territory when they were ambushed by Lebanese troops. More in this report from IBA's Ariel Reshef.
The UNIFIL peacekeeping mission in southern Lebanon today confirmed that the Lebanese army fired the first shots in yesterday's exchange of fire. UNIFIL officials also substantiated IDF claims that the attack was premeditated and unprovoked. In a video released to the media shortly after the clashes, UNIFIL soldiers are seen shouting at the IDF to halt their activity.
Stop, stop, please, please, stop! Down! Down, down! Hey, stop! Stop! Stop doing anything! Stop!
Reports are circulating that a Lebanese company commander ordered troops to create an incident to impress various media outlets, but told troops to fire in the air. A local commander then allegedly ordered the targeting of Israeli soldiers directly. A senior UNIFIL political advisor confirmed that the IDF had informed UNIFIL and the Lebanese army of the routine maintenance work, which the LAF claimed ignited the incident. The UN interim force called on both parties to restore quiet on the border.
Our immediate priority of UNIFIL is to restore calm in the area. Our acting force commander, General Bonfanti, has been in contact with the top leadership on with the Lebanese army and with the command of the Israeli army, urging maximum restraint.
A Lebanese army official issued a statement to the press in which he too confirmed that Lebanese troops opened fire first. The LAF maintains that Israeli soldiers entered Lebanese territory and that the attack constituted a defense of Lebanese sovereignty. UNIFIL, however, found that the IDF did not cross the border. Al Jazeera reported today that the LAF remains on high alert and has augmented its presence near the border. Lebanese President Michel Suleiman urged the Lebanese army to confront any Israeli aggression, whatever the sacrifices. In the wake of yesterday's clash, today the IDF is operating as usual on the northern border and is continuing maintenance as scheduled. A UNIFIL force of 13,000 peacekeeping personnel carriers is patrolling the highway along the demarcation blue line. The incident was sparked yesterday when IDF troops began clearing vegetation along the border fence that was obstructing their line of sight. UNIFIL was informed of the IDF's operation and notified Lebanese forces. Lebanese soldiers demanded the IDF move back from the fence, and when the IDF refused, the Lebanese troops opened fire from a house east of the nearby village of Adesa. An IDF tank returned fire, and an IDF armored personnel carrier targeted three Lebanese army outposts. The Lebanese army then fired mortars and RPGs into Israeli territory. The IDF believes that the attack was planned 2 to 3 hours in advance. The deadly incident claimed the lives of Israeli battalion commander Dov Harari, three Lebanese soldiers, and a Lebanese journalist. IDF company commander Ezra Lakia suffered critical wounds to the chest and is now being treated in Rambam Medical Center in Haifa. This is Ariel Reshef for IBA News.
من جدة حيث التقى العاهل السعودي أعلن الرئيس الفلسطيني محمود عباس أنه لا يمانع الدخول في
Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas, who met with the Saudi monarch in Jeddah, said that he doesn't object to holding direct talks with Israel based on the terms of reference that include hating the settlement campaign and using the 1967 border line as the basis for these talks. Abu Mazen is facing mounting international and U.S. pressure to begin direct talks with Israel. What will the Israelis gain and the Palestinians lose from such talks? Our correspondent Mohammed Al-Sayed reports from Ramallah.
نتابع تقرير مراسلنا محمد السيد من رام الله.
لم يكن النجاح حليف المفاوضات.
Success was not the result of the indirect negotiations between the Palestinians and the Israelis, who met under the auspices of U.S. Mideast envoy George Mitchell. The U.S. administration continues to mount pressure on the Palestinians to hold direct talks with Israel without guarantees. Israel also calls for unconditional direct talks, unyielding to the terms of Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas. Abbas demanded that Israel halt all settlement activities in the West Bank and occupied Jerusalem prior to holding direct talks. Israel's position seems to be shared by the U.S. and the Europeans. The Israeli government has rejected the Palestinian terms and announced it will resume its settlement activities in the West Bank at the end of next month, following a 10-month halt.
If we move now to the direct talks, without guarantees, nothing will prevent Israel from launching a new intensive settlement campaign on September 14th or 16th. If this happens, we could find ourselves trapped in direct talks, and our position becomes weaker.
Direct talks, once launched, will begin at the starting point, focusing on final status issues, such as the borders of the Palestinian state. The former government of Ehud Olmert witnessed negotiations at unprecedented levels, but failed to produce any tangible results on the ground.
We must have international partners. We must internationalize our plight. If we meet with the Israelis alone, we will ultimately pay the price. Israel is an immature state with an immature mind, an immature society.
Arabs have recently given the Palestinian president the green light to hold direct talks with the Israelis. However, several Palestinian factions rejected holding direct talks with Israel, leaving the ball in Abu Mazen's court. The Palestinian president is facing mounting pressure that recently escalated to threats of straining relations between the U.S. administration and the Palestinian Authority. Israel insists on holding direct talks, which the Palestinians already prejudged as useless. Many Palestinians believe that the direct negotiations will likely drag them to the edge of a dangerous cliff, especially amidst the Israeli position on settlements, which has been clear even before the launch of such talks. Mohammed Al-Sayed, Dubai TV, Ramallah.
Ten children took a trip to Slovenia to treat injuries left behind by the Israeli war machine on their young bodies. The group shares similar injuries, but for Nur Abu Samra, it differed. The 10-year-old was the victim of a brotherly bullet due to Palestinian division in Gaza. Details from Slovenia with Ghassan Abulos.
Nur Abu Samra is part of a group of children receiving treatment in Slovenia. Similar to her friends, she is injured. But she differs from them by the pain that was caused by the brothers of the Israeli occupation. The pain of the struggle and division between Fatah and Hamas in Gaza, which took place nearly 3 years ago, is still present on the mind of this child, as well as her body.
Fatah and Hamas were fighting, and I accidentally got shot. The bullet entered my stomach and exited my back.
Nur only says a few words to describe the Palestinian division that left its traces behind, with a bullet that penetrated her stomach and exited her back. This led to partial paralysis of the lower extremities and pelvic and muscle weakness.
I'm better now because of the treatment. I've improved and can now walk better.
In addition to her walking aid, Nur needs medical follow-up and rehabilitation after her treatment. In between physical and psychological treatments, Nur turns her back to the criminal, and in it, the prick of a needle reaches the bones of the brothers in Palestine. From the Slovenian capital, Ljubljana, Ghassan Abulos, Al Arabiya.
Al Arabiya.
France has declared war on Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Arab Maghreb countries after the killing of hostage Michel Gerbanot. The French confirmed that the war against the organization will be intensified, as Sarkozy said that the crime will not go unpunished. This war needs to be conducted in coordination with the Sahel countries, most notably Algeria, which rejects any foreign interference from outside the joint military headquarters that were created by the relevant countries.
The killing of Michel Gerbanot by Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb will not pass by peacefully. This is what French President Nicolas Sarkozy confirmed, and it was reiterated by French Prime Minister François Fillon immediately after Al-Qaeda announced the killing of the French hostage. If this region of the African Sahel, which extends as far as the eye can see and includes Mauritania, Mali, and Niger, the activities of Al-Qaeda in West Africa are widespread. So what can France do to prevent the danger that Al-Qaeda poses in the Islamic Maghreb? The French military presence in the region is represented by the following: dozens of Mauritanian special forces capable of quickly interfering, a military base in Dakar supplied with an airplane capable of monitoring human movement in the desert, and three additional bases in Gabon, Chad, and Djibouti. According to some, these capabilities are insufficient.
It is not possible to do more than what is being done because French capabilities are spread out between Afghanistan, Lebanon, and the Sahel coast, in addition to a number of African countries. If we consider the capabilities of French defense, then we won't be able to exert a lot of effort in the Sahel countries.
In the shadow of these facts, is it possible for France to completely end al-Qaeda's presence in the Islamic Maghreb, especially since the latter holds 500 armed men who are spread out across a large territory?
I believe that the military option will not be sufficient to end al-Qaeda's presence in the Islamic Maghreb.
The facts on the ground won't be the only obstacle facing France's war on al-Qaeda. Algerian Foreign Minister Mourad Meldissi rejected the participation of French forces in any military operation, saying that the countries of the region are the ones with the expertise.
A military source in Nouakchott reported that the Mauritanian army has recovered the bodies of the seven al-Qaeda members who were killed during a joint French-Mauritanian operation in the Islamic Maghreb last Thursday.
The targeting of Iraqi scholars and figures continues to play out. Thousands of residents in the city of Fallujah held a funeral procession for Sheikh Ihsan al-Duri, the imam and preacher of al-Rawi Mosque. Al-Duri, along with his companion Sheikh Mustafa Fauzi, were gunned down as they were leaving al-Rawi Mosque last Wednesday. The Association of Muslim Scholars in Iraq has condemned the crime and warned against the ongoing targeting of Muslim scholars. The association also called on the Iraqi people to unite against all manipulative plans which are being funded by foreign groups.
A somber day was observed today in the city of Fallujah, where a local leader was martyred in a cowardly attack. The attack on Fallujah seems to serve the interests of the occupation and its allies, as well as those seeking to conspire against Iraq by targeting its scholars and prominent figures. Thousands of residents in Fallujah held a funeral procession for Sheikh Ihsan al-Dawri, the imam and preacher of al-Rawi Mosque. Al-Dawri was laid to rest in the martyrs' cemetery in Fallujah.
We, the residents of Fallujah, are gathered here to bid farewell to one of Fallujah's fallen stars, scholar and Sheikh Ihsan al-Dawri. May God bless him and rest his soul. This cowardly attack is part of a bigger plot being hatched against the country and the city of Fallujah, which has witnessed more than its share of assassination attempts. This security breach is being fueled by the occupation and its supporters. They're helping the occupation destroy the country's existence. They've launched an assassination campaign against religious scholars and thinkers, as well as against the country's intellectuals and prominent figures. This campaign only serves the interest of the occupation and its allies and aims to destroy the straight path of Islam and its common beliefs of tolerance, righteousness, and guidance.
Al-Dawri died of wounds sustained in a blast that targeted him as he walked out of al-Rawi Mosque in central Fallujah, where he performed the evening prayer. He was transported to a local hospital, where he later died due to hemorrhaging. The residents, who continue to suffer from the occupation and its collaborators, have strongly condemned the cowardly attack on the imam and expressed grief over his loss.
What the city of Fallujah in Anbar province are witnessing today is nothing but payback for the patriotic position taken by the city against the US-led occupation. The city is paying the price on behalf of all of Iraq, the united Iraq. We hereby ask God to lift this dark cloud, bless our martyrs and have mercy on them.
Despite repeated claims by the followers of the occupation that they are maintaining control over the country's affairs, the situation on the ground doesn't seem to support such claims. Many are wondering how the attackers were able to breach the security siege that has been placed on the city of Fallujah by the government forces.
All indications point to the occupation and its collaborators. Everyone knows that Fallujah has been placed under tight siege from all directions. In fact, all of Fallujah's neighborhoods have been placed under siege. It appears that the breach was made possible by the security agencies.
The targeting of Iraqi scholars and figures, many who are well respected in Iraq, has sent one message by the occupation and its supporters. This message reads, "The violation of sanctity and betrayal are two sides of the same coin, a coin that will eventually be tossed in the trash bin of history."
There's been fresh clashes between Indian police and pro-independence protesters that have left three protesters dead and at least 10 more injured. The three were killed when Indian security forces opened fire on protesters in Srinagar. The deaths sparked further angry demonstrations. Despite a strict curfew imposed by Indian authorities, Kashmir has been rocked by waves of pro-independence protests. After the death of a teenager back in June, he died when he was struck by a tear gas shell fired by Indian police during an anti-Indian rule demonstration. Unrest in Kashmir has left at least 47 people dead since the latest round of protests erupted 2 months ago.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.